Last time we left off in Cabo de San Jose. Now we'll begin this episode with a goodbye, and let's end it with a hello.
Conocerte, Samantha y Travieso.
Igualmente.
Donde quiera que anden, Dios los bendiga siempre.
Gracias.
Muchas felicidades por venir aquí a San José.
Oh, yeah.
Y que sigan pasándosela muy bien.
Gracias, muy bien.
We left our Mexican family and went north, stopping for a night at a geothermal spring, hitting a beach, then headed back to La Paz before finally catching a boat to the interior. And oh yeah, we saw a bunch of free-roaming goats and had a Han Solo bicycle sighting. Not even kidding.
We're here camping. We made it to Santa Rita.
Kind of a rough road to get here, but we have made it. We got to talk, well, sweet talk, the old man, who is, if nothing else, nothing short of a Eeyore type of Mexican dude. Wasn't looking like he was gonna let us in because they were at full capacity at 30%, but we eventually kind of worked him, or he just took pity on us and let us camp.
We set up our tent site. I just woke up from a nap, and now we decided to eat some food. But it was a long wait getting in here.
Mm-hmm.
We went down a lot of dirt, windy paths through the mountains. Some of them I just walked up because I didn't want to be on the bike and then off the bike from falling.
I did not feel like turning around on the same day to go out another 2.5 kilometers in rough road just to be told no and go all the way back to town and try to find another place to stay. So I'm glad we made it. I'm also glad we bought this hammock in San Jose. Una hamaca hecha a mano, wey. Finally got my sweetheart to her magical place. Aguas Termales. Hot springs. Back to La Paz and reunited with our boy Fabian. Turns out he decided to hang his hat at the last spot that we were at when we stayed in La Paz.
All right, amigo, time to tear it up.
We spent a few days with him as he prepared to fly back to Switzerland. He showed me some parts around La Paz I hadn't seen before. Got to share some bro time, just him and I, on an afternoon ride, while Sam got to relax in our room talking to girlfriends and looking at our budget. All was going great until doomsday came for my drone. But I'll have recently returned home Fabian explain what happened.
Travis and I, we went to do some drone shots in Mexico. And we went to the coast and took some very nice drone shots. He flew out over the ocean about 1 or 2 minutes. And then he said, it's time to turn back. And he put it on sport mode. And yeah, we were talking, and after a while we heard a crash behind us, and we just saw the drone tumbling down the hill, and we thought, it's gonna be broken. He went down and got it, and we checked everything, and one arm was broken off, and everything else was fine. The gimbal was good, the camera was okay, and he was very lucky to didn't lose his drone.
Dumb luck, but luck nonetheless. I'll take it. We'll be right back. Time had come to an end with Fabian and I. We had a ferry to catch. I knew I was going to miss the guy.
Time had come to say goodbye to our friend Fabian, but first I had to go get some medical work done, and then we were ready to board the ferry. And here's how we did that.
¿Cómo se llega?
Voy a dar una vuelta.
¿Quieres ir a la báscula?
Okay, come on.
I'm glad that didn't take long. So many people had trouble at this point. Buenas tardes.
Serían 93 pesos, jefe, de acceso a la terminal de su
vehículo. Okay, perfecto. ¿Y tengo que colgarlo aquí o da igual?
No. Tiene que pasar a confirmar en el área de ventas. En cuanto confirmen, se va de embarque porque ya se va el barco.
Ya pronto, ok.
Sí, sí.
Ok, vamos
allá. Hasta luego.
Gracias.
Gracias.
Buen viaje.
Gracias.
Nos han mandado por aquí para confirmar esto.
¿Tiene su boleto?
Sí, ZH.
Ok. ¿ID?
Sí. ¿Los dos o solo el mío?
Los dos. Ok. ¿Eso ya no está nosotros?
Sí.
¿Cuál es la parte que salta de derecho y la motocicleta operador y cabina? Y hay que pasar rápido, ya es tarde.
Ok, ok.
Buenas.
Deja su boleto, por favor.
¿Cuál es tu nombre?
Travis. T-R-A-V-I-S. El apellido M-O-T-T. Ok. Gracias. Ya veo. Y pongo los cinchos aquí.
Sí, por favor. Ahí quedan esos.
Ok, gracias.
Tienes, lo puedo poner aquí, hacia aquel lado, uh-huh. Acá, con cuatro puntos.
Ok, entendido. Gracias. Ok, este barco está de lujo, ¿eh?
Sí.
¿Pueden pasar ahorita al restaurante?
Ok.
Hey everyone, we're on Baja Ferries. We are heading from Pichilingue, something like that.
That's it.
To Mazatlan. It's 12 hours, but we get dinner included, and we get some breakfast, some coffee and bread. We have a cabin to stay in, there's movies going in here, music, lots of people, lots of food, check out our food. Call my family to tell them I'm on a big boat.
Mama!
Yeah, we're on the boat now. We didn't leave yet, we're about to leave.
It's morning time, and we're on a boat.
Buen día.
Perfecto, gracias.
¿Tiene caballero?
Did you know Pan is actually Japanese as well? So you do speak some? Antes no Pan ga chotto tokuteru. Nande?
All right. Terra firma. Here we are.
We arrived on the mainland in the Mexican state of Sinaloa. In the colonial days of New Spain, the Sinaloa River Valley was the site of a reunion of Spaniards that became legend in its own time. A lost royal treasurer, his two fellow Castilian noblemen, and one Moorish slave were the fateful few who emerged from the ill-fated Narváez Expedition. Of approximately 300 men who had arrived in Florida, only four returned. I only first learned about this story in a book titled It Happened in Texas. I still see it as a failure of the Texas public school system that I hadn't learned this story in particular during my truant tenure of high school. Totally their fault. Anyways, true history always blows Hollywood out of the water, especially when it involves signs and wonders, improbable stories of survival, and faith in the face of execution, starvation, cannibalism, and epidemics. These elements all form the skeletal frame of any legend. So let's get to it. This is the hyper-condensed true survival story of Alvar Núñez Cabeza de Vaca. It is April 1536. Four horsemen sat on their mounts, overlooking the river valley. It wasn't even called Sinaloa yet. They were out beyond the borders of New Spain. They were out hunting fresh indigenous slaves, something technically forbidden by their king. New Spain's encomienda system had insatiable taste for slave labor, unfortunately, and these horsemen viewed the indigenous people as natural slaves. The four men saw in the distance a mass approaching them. A very unlikely sight, being that they'd gone 3 days beyond the range of their countrymen. Nobody with any sense would approach them, understanding very well who they were. But here they were, coming directly toward the slavers, who had been terrorizing their homeland for several years. Much to their dismay, they found 13 of these men before them, 11 appearing to be natives, with long black hair, tattoos, wearing simple skins or loincloths. The other two were even more perplexing. One had skin darker than all the others, darker than a Moor, as dark as the Africans who had just only begun to arrive in the New World much farther to the east in order to replace the dying natives. The other man walking alongside was even stranger because he looked, as backwards as it may be, a lot like the horseman. His hair and his beard were just like theirs, just much lighter. His skin was seasoned a near permanent shade of pink, like a Castilian who'd been exposed to the sun for far too long. Both were dressed just like native, only they donned sort of ceremonial gourds around their waist, like some sort of native medicine men. What in the world were a black man and a Castilian doing out here? As surreal as it was for the slavers, it must have been even more so for the two bearded men. They stood in silence, everything absolutely still. Usually these men would dismount and place everyone before them in chains. Not today. Someone had to say something, but just how would you relate to your own countrymen just what you'd seen and what you'd become in the last decade? The four horsemen shared their language, but now, the black Moor, known as Estebanico, and the Castilian Cabeza de Vaca, saw their own as familiar, but now strangely foreign. Just how do you begin? 9 years ago, they'd sailed away from the Iberian Peninsula. Since then, they'd landed in Florida. They'd left 90% of their fellow expeditionaries buried along the Gulf Coast, wrecked their rafts on Galveston Island in Texas, been reduced to slavery, scattered among the natives on the coast. One had won his freedom by making himself a merchant, only to return himself to slavery, willingly, in hopes of being closer to rumors of his companions nearby. They had survived winters, epidemics, and treachery, but that is only the beginning. The four remaining survivors of that Florida expedition had been reunited during the Great South Texas Prickly Pear Range Harvest and courageously escaped from slavery to make their way overland to New Spain, only to become the instruments of the miraculous healing of hundreds, possibly thousands of Native Americans, culminating with the resurrection of a hand-to-God dead man and the successful surgical extraction of an arrowhead from a dying man's heart. How do you relate these events to someone who wasn't there? How do you explain the fact you'd become the focal point of possibly one of the largest mass spiritual movements in the history of Native America? How do you explain that 600 of your followers, in fact, were in the next valley over with the other two expedition survivors, awaiting to see how this meeting would go with these four mounted slavers, whose trail they had picked up on the last 3 days before? And just how do you tell these slavers that their hardened faces denoted what was the very end of this incredible journey? Well, you don't. You simply say, Me llamo Alvar Núñez de Cabeza de Vaca. Llévenos a vuestro capitán. Just as he did. It was more or less Easter 1536, and for all intents and purposes, the man had just come back from the dead. Because everyone, every last Spaniard in the New World, knew that Alvar Núñez Cabeza de Vaca had died along with all 300 other of the men with Governor Panfilo de Narváez's doomed Florida expedition. But Sam can tell you all about that next time.